There are but moments in a thousand years. In the parable of the talents, we see how we are given a certain amount and also a certain amount of time with which to use it. At the end of a person's life, one looks on and one sees in the coffin a time concluded, a talent given, an innings played, and time is no more. Indeed, the question poses itself each time we are before this full stop. And me, where is my time and my merit? What am I doing with what I am given? Because of the influence of sacred scripture on our language, the word talent has come to mean what we mean now by talent, but it is actually the great weight of money. We have our gift, our givenness. Some are born with handicaps, some are born with great mental handicaps. They can only do a certain amount upon earth, but they too can beam, they can give much love, and they are pure. Oftentimes they will get there more easily because of that candid simplicity, uncontaminated by complication and all that goes with it. Whereas those who have much can have much to deal with, and can use it for good or for bad. I think of two who were given a great deal. Henry VIII, he wasn't at all dense. He actually wrote well in defense of the sacraments, but he had a problem. And the authors tell us there was an abuse of grace going on in his life. He could only see one thing, and everything had to work in function of that. Did he make it, despite all that he was given at his birth? And then, far closer to us in time, we have the likes of Joseph Stalin and Adolf Hitler, extremely powerful individuals, given responsibility and power over huge numbers and whole continents. But did they make it? I remember years ago in a big national event in Carmarthen in Wales, when in a time of discernment, it was hosted by the National Charismatic Renewal, and it was actually very powerful. And we had one priest who had gifts and who used them. At a certain point, we were in intense prayer. It was in the context of the Eucharist itself, and we were trying precisely as Europe was actually changing course to do things, imploring the power of heaven upon earth. It was the very moment that the Berlin Wall was coming down. And we were praying for the souls of the architects of that revolution and its perpetuation. Lenin and Stalin. At a certain point, powerful knowledge came through that they were in a different dimension and could not be reached at all. So we understood, it seems, they were beyond hope. It was a frightening moment. And then closer to us, we have what happened in Germany. I remember talking when living for a while at Tettenweiss with the chaplain of those holy Benedictine nuns about the situation of Germany and Austria. He was a very good friend and chaplain, and he would not permit a single word of English, so as to oblige me to try and speak properly the language I was there to learn. And I remember on a walk together that we discussed Adolf Hitler, and he calmly told the story of the German chaplain who, during a holiday, colony vacances, with the youth, had been instrumental in changing the course of history. It was when the young Adolf Hitler fell into the river. The chaplain, the Catholic chaplain, because it was of course a Catholic country, jumped in immediately and rescued the child. I remember the concluding remark, without a priest, world history would have been totally different, Gans anders. Indeed, in the First World War, in a trench, he felt that he'd been providentially preserved because he just missed a shell in the trench. He always thought that he was protected by some numinous power. He rose to power himself, and with all authority in his hands, he could do an awful lot for good or for evil. And then we know how the end came, and how, rather unexpectedly, Eva Braun opted to come from Berchtesgaden to die with him, and she did, in the same bunker, in the same room. Orders were given that they should be burned so as not to be in any way humiliated after death. And it occurred to me, maybe that fidelity of Eva Braun, in its own way heroic, perhaps in a strange way could have been her redeeming factor. We don't know. But we do know from exorcism that the voice of Hitler has been heard, coming from the wrong side. Ich bin Hitler. And then one sees in the balance what glory is and what merit is. In that balance, we see an ancient truth coming through, which is very close to here, at the old Celtic cross of Monaster Bois, still standing, where at the top, we have the naked soul in the scale, with a demon on one side, an angel on the other, and the little man, puzzled and somewhat bewildered, indeed apprehensive to the utmost, which way will this go forever?